Good morning. Welcome to Doylestown Presbyterian Church on this first Sunday in September and the unofficial or official end of summer. Welcome on this day as we gather here and at home, north, south, east, and west, wherever you might be. You are welcome as we gather together as God's people to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us worship God.
Responsive call to worship. Happy are those who meditate on wisdom and reflect in their heart on her ways and ponder her secrets.
Let me hear what you will speak when I charge you in my heart.
Heed the counsel of your own heart, and above all, pray to the Most High that you may be guided in the way of truth.
How precious is your steadfast
love of God. Friends, you and I have been created in God's image and redeemed by the gift of life we find in Jesus Christ. And yet, because we are human, we fall short of our response to God's call upon us. And thus, we need times when we come before our Maker and confess our sin, trusting that even that act cannot break the bond of God's love for us. We will come and together in a time of confession, as is our practice, first by offering the prayer found in your bulletin or printed on the screen, and then continue with our individual confessions. But there is a typo in the first line that I should have caught in proofing that it not, but it's a very critical difference in what we are praying, and that is in the first sentence, we are saying, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, not ours." So let us come before our Maker and confess our sin. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone have I sinned, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. Friends, who is in a position to condemn us on this day? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ intercedes for you and for me. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
This morning's Old Testament lesson is taken from Daniel chapter 6, verses 19 through 28, found on page 827 in your pew Bible. Please listen to the word of the Lord. Then at break of day, the king got up and hurried to the den of lions. When he came near the den where Daniel was, he cried out anxiously to Daniel, "O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you faithfully serve, been able to deliver you from the lions?" Daniel then said to the king, "O king, live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths so that they would not hurt me, because I was found blameless before him and also before you. O king, I have done no wrong." Then the king was exceedingly glad and commanded that Daniel be taken out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no kind of harm was found on him because he had trusted in his God. The king gave a command, and those who had accused Daniel were brought and thrown into the den of lions, they, their children, and their wives. Before they reached the bottom of the den, the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones in pieces. Then King Darius wrote to all the peoples and nations of every language throughout the whole world, "May you have abundant prosperity. I make a decree that in all my royal dominion, people should tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, enduring forever. His kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion has no end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. For he has saved Daniel from the power of the lions." So this Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus. the Persian. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I invite the children at home to gather around the screen for a time for children. And if there are any children here in the sanctuary that would like to join me on the front row, I would be glad to greet you. Good morning, boys and girls. I'm glad to be with you this morning. If you were listening to the scripture that was read just a few minutes ago, it was from the book of Daniel. And over the last few weeks, we've been in the book of Daniel for Sunday mornings. We've been hearing and reading about the stories of Daniel and his life. He was a pretty remarkable man. Well, today, the reading is about one of the most significant, important moments in Daniel's life, when Daniel was in great danger. Daniel had been accused that he was not a loyal subject of the king, and as punishment, he was to be thrown into a den of lions. I want to share this picture with you. This is the way someone imagined Daniel in the lion's den. Now take a close look at some of those lions. To me, they look very scary. And Daniel, he doesn't look afraid. He seems very calm. In fact, he is staring at the lions just as they are staring at him. And in fact, if you look closely, some of those lions even look like they're afraid of Daniel. We don't know whether Daniel was afraid in the lion's den, but it was a very, very, very scary situation that he was in. But he trusted in God, and he had prayed. Do you know that one of the most frequent words in the Bible is, do not be afraid? I did a search on the internet, and just about every book in the Bible has one or two verses in which God or an angel or a prophet says, do not be afraid. There are plenty of times in our lives when we can be afraid of all kinds of things. And sometimes we don't know what to do with our fear. But I want you and me to remember that Jesus and God has always reminded us, do not be afraid, for I am with you. In fact, one of the things that Jesus said to his disciples right before he went back to heaven, he said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Do not be afraid. And so while Daniel was able to escape the lion's den because God protected him, and even if he was afraid, he trusted that God was with him. And so let's remember the words that God says over and over and over again in the Bible, do not be afraid. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you that you assure us that you love us and that you are with us and that we do not need to be afraid. Help us to remember this always. In Jesus' name, amen. It was great to be with you. Hope you have a good week. Remember, Jesus loves you. Our second reading this morning comes from the book of Acts, the 12th chapter, reading verses 1 through 12. About that time, King Herod laid violent hands upon some who belonged to the church. He had James, the brother of John, killed with the sword. After he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. This was during the festival of unleavened bread. When he had seized him, he put him in prison and handed him over to four squads of soldiers to guard him, intending to bring him out to the people after Passover. While Peter was kept in prison, the church prayed fervently to God for him. The very night before Herod was going to bring him out, Peter, bound with two chains, was sleeping between two guards, while guards in front of the door kept keeping watch over the prison. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared and a light shone in the cell. He tapped Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly," and the chains fell off his wrists. The angel said to him, "Fasten your belt and put on your sandals." So he did. Then he said to him, "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." Peter went out and followed him. He did not realize what was happening with the angel's help, that it was real. He thought he was seeing a vision. After they had passed the first and the second guard, they came before the iron gate leading into the city. It opened for them of its own accord, and they went outside and walked along a lane, when suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I am sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the hands of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting." As soon as he realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose other name was Mark, where many had gathered and were praying. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious God, we read the texts of the stories of great men and women of the past, and we tend to keep them at arm's length, but we know that your word is alive and that it is for us today here in this place. So help us hear the message that you have as we trust through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today we come to the completion of a journey through the first six chapters of Daniel. We finish our sermon series with the release of Daniel from the den of lions. We've taken 3 weeks in this sixth chapter to focus on the events that generally define Daniel's life. But this sixth chapter has been divided into three portions, and the first portion, the plot against Daniel, John preached several weeks ago. Last week, Becca taught us from the portion of chapter 6 where Daniel is thrown into the lion's den, and today Daniel is saved from the lions. Over the many years of Daniel living in exile from Israel, he had proved time and time again that he was a man of skill and integrity, honesty, and amazing gifts. He had risen through the ranks, and he had been appointed into leadership by three kings. Currently, the king was Darius, who was reigning over Babylon, and he had been appointed by Darius as one of three presidents who oversaw 20 satraps, or governors, who were all the king's representatives throughout the land. Now, even amongst the three presidents, Daniel distinguished himself, and this resulted in jealousy. And the evil eye of avarice was being awakened. And they determined to find fault with Daniel, but they could find none. So they devised a plan whereby he would be accused of being disloyal and a traitor because of his religious practices. Manipulating the king, these leaders created a trap that they knew would result in Daniel being killed in a most gruesome and violent way by being thrown into a den of ravenous lions. The text tells us that Daniel was aware of this plot and the document that had been signed by the king that would be his death warrant. All he needed to do was to stop praying for 30 days, but he did not. Daniel was not going to be controlled by the evil desires of powerful men, nor was he going to set aside his worship and his prayers to the God who had sustained him and been with him since his youth. The story begins today with a hungry and tired King Darius rushing to the lion's den, anxiously seeking out Daniel. "Daniel, servant of the living God," he calls into the darkness of the den. "Has your God, whom you faithfully serve, been able to deliver you from the lions?" Do you hear what King Darius is declaring in that one sentence? Daniel is a servant, but not his, a servant of the living God. not a lowercase g God, but an uppercase, bold, living, active, attentive, involved, ever-present God. Daniel, Darius cries out, has this living God who you so faithfully serve been able to save you? Darius had hope that the living God could indeed move into a desperate and most assuredly unlivable situation and save his servant Daniel. Darius, in his respect and concern for Daniel, had hope that a living God would intervene in a dangerous and desperate situation. So while we focus on Daniel and his rescue and God's power, the other character in this story is a pagan king who wields power, often in capricious and careless ways, crying out in hope. Hope in a living God. A God that is distinguished from all the other pantheon of gods of the time and the culture, the living one, the active one, the one who sees and hears and knows and saves. As we read and heard in the text, once Darius is assured of Daniel's safety, he makes a declaration, an affirmation. It's in verses 26 to 28. Let me read them again. I make a decree that in all my royal dominion, people should tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for he is a living God enduring forever. His kingdom shall never be destroyed. His dominion will have no end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth, for he has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. Wow. Did anyone see that coming? What an outcome. What a reaction. It was not what was expected. A chorus from my Sunday school days has been going through my head, and as I have been keeping company with this text. Maybe you're already singing it too. Dare to be a Daniel. Dare to be a Daniel. Dare to stand alone. Dare to have a purpose firm. Dare to make it known. As children, we were invited to be like Daniel. To be brave and confident, to share our faith and face trials of danger, like Daniel did. We were encouraged to not be afraid or ashamed to be known as a Christian or a follower of Jesus. But as I reflect back now to my childhood teaching, there was something that as a child I could not access. Daniel's bravery and faith did not come from his character. It did not come from his gifts, his personal determination, or his intentions. Who Daniel was in his adult life was an expression of a lifetime of living out his faith in an ever-present, difficult, and challenging world. Daniel lived out his faith and committed himself to worship of the living God. Day in and day out, when he was taken from his homeland and his family and his friends and taken into exile, through persecution, injustice, powerful kings who were ruthless and careless with their power, in dangers and temptations, alongside jealous co-workers and scheming, spying neighbors, fiery furnaces and hungry lions, Daniel's life had been a long obedience in the same direction. I can't take credit for that phrase. It's a book titled by Reverend Eugene Peterson, who was a Presbyterian church minister and also author of The Message. Years ago, Eugene Peterson wrote a book on discipleship, How to Follow Jesus, and the title was A Long Obedience in the Same Direction. Daniel had lived his life in communication with God through daily prayers, through trials of what to eat, who to pray to, how to worship, who to bow down to. Through it all, Daniel had remained true to God. In quiet faithfulness, Daniel prayed and worshiped and trusted, seeking mercy with the circumstances of his life. If Daniel was to have a gravestone, I would offer that these words would be appropriately written on it, a long obedience in the same direction. Daniel was not what would be called a foxhole believer. Daniel did not only seek God when times were tough, but his very life was centered around the living God, who was the God to be worshiped, a power source to be called on, a monarch who was the king of all kings. Daniel's life was consistently focused on the one in whom the rise and fall of kings and kingdoms was determined, as well as the fate of people great and small. In theological terms, what Daniel's life was based on was the sovereignty of God. And this sovereign God was living and active and engaged in the events of humanity and kingdoms. Now, this theological concept can become problematic, especially if we give in to the idea of a powerful and sovereign God that is devoid of love and grace. If we think that God only sees us as pieces of a chess game in which God is playing both sides, or that we have no agency or will in our circumstances or our lives, that is not the sovereign God that we believe in, nor the sovereign God of Daniel. And that's not the concept I'm offering today. Proclaiming the sovereignty of the living God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, does not mean that God capriciously uses humanity for good or destructive purpose. Rather, it is an understanding, a ground of being, a worldview that is based on the one who is all-powerful, all-wise, all-knowing, all-loving, all-sacrificing, who gives God's very self to redeem us. The sovereign God who longs for us with the heart of a father. Dare to be a Daniel, the Sunday school chorus goes, as we are surrounded by foes that pursue us. The foes that could result in our rejecting the living God, mistrusting the promises of Jesus or the nudgings of the Holy Spirit. Foes that can divert us from our path of discipleship. What are some of those foes? Our hedonistic pleasure-seeking culture that entices us to believe that what we have now and what we experience now is all that matters. Our egos that tempt us to seek our own self-importance and find our own self-worth by the accolades of others. Our success when we think that it confirms that we're better than everyone else. Our wealth that we use for our own pleasure while casting unfounded judgments on those who are poor or disadvantaged or who lack the basic necessities of life. Or our safety, where we would sacrifice what is good and right and caring for our own personal safety with disregard for neighbors or our community. Or the foe of happiness, which can cloud our ability to make decisions for a time of temporary suffering or denial in order to achieve a greater good. Or how about fear? It can be a foe that takes us off the path of faith and trust when it causes us to begin to trust in ourselves, to mistrust others, to doubt God's ability to see us through times of danger and uncertainty. Or one of my personal favorites, the foe of control. I'm in charge. As the expression goes, it's my way or the highway. That if what is happening to me is not according to my plans, my hopes, my dreams, my wants, I become angry at God. I tell God through my thoughts and my actions, it's my way or the highway. All of these are foes and many more. All that can knock us off our path of following Christ, our loving God, trusting that God is leading us step by step and day by day through the circumstances around us, and that God is with us. For Daniel, it was a day by day, morning by morning, evening by evening, long obedience in the same direction. Faithfulness in prayer, in worship, in praise, no matter what was happening around him. Dare we be a Daniel? Yes, we dare. Live like Daniel, each day with prayer and trust, openness to God's presence and God's provision. Dare to be a Daniel. Dare to be a Daniel with a commitment to a long obedience in the same direction. I'm going to close today with a line from a poem that was written by a Sufi poet from the Persian culture of King Darius. This was written thousands of years ago, but I see it as an invitation to respond to the witness of Daniel. Come, join the courageous who have no choice but to bet their entire world that indeed, indeed, God is real. May it be so. Amen.
We'd like again to welcome all of you who are joining us for worship, either in the sanctuary or online. And we want to know of your presence with us. So encourage those of you in the sanctuary to take the Act of Friendship pad that you'll find at the end of the center aisle and write your name on it. Pass it to those who are next to you, taking notice as it comes back. Those of you who are worshiping with us online, the DPC Connect card is an opportunity for you to pass along prayer concerns, to learn more about this community of faith, and to let us know of your presence with us today. As you're involved in those activities, I would lift up a couple of announcements about things that are happening. On the back of the bulletin, you will see another opportunity for you to pass on your suggestions for individuals that our nominating committee should consider as future deacons or ruling elders in our church. If you have not already done so, we'd encourage you to pass along those ideas in the next couple days as the committee meets again and begins its work. Yesterday was posted our new quarterly version of the Tidings, our newsletter. Members should have gotten a link to that, but in either case, you can go to our website and to see it, and you'll begin to see all the things that are beginning to start up again, even in the midst of masks. Even with the Delta variant, we continue to plan and move forward in creative ministries here. Choir rehearsals begin this week, and in the days that follow, you will see other ways that we'll be coming together for learning, for service, and for fellowship. And so I encourage you to to read through that and to plan to be with this family of faith in new ways in the coming days. 2 weeks from today, our worship service will take place on Mechanics Street. So weather permitting, we will be outside on both sides of the bridge gathering for worship. Following that, there will also be a luncheon provided for you, opportunity for us to come back together in person, but here on our site. And so I encourage you to come and be part of that morning with us as well. You'll see on the communion table that we are celebrating the birth of four babies in recent days. Colette Marie Vandegrift, born to Sonny and Austin Vandegrift. DPC grandfather is Craig Gerritsen. Alexandra Rose Mamadoff, born to Vladimir and Natalia Mamadoff, and DPC grandparents are Soren and Svetlana. And then Declan and Finley Van Wagner, twin boys, born on September 1st to Ryan and Amanda Van Wagner, and the proud grandparents, maybe here, Bill and Candy Van Wagner. We do celebrate these new lives in our family of faith and the joy they have already brought. Last week, we made you aware of the death of Gina Gerritsen and want to let you know that the gathering to celebrate her life will happen on Friday of this week. Family will be assembling in the Celtic Cross Room starting at 9:30 to meet with you, and then the service will begin here at 10:30, again on Friday of this week. We are not aware of any member of the church in the hospital, but we did have other prayer requests that lift up for you. Cindy Harris has requested prayers for her friend Sherry's family on the death of their son, Danto. Eileen Roth is asking for prayers for Maria. Art and Mary Shaw are prayers for their friend William, who is in ICU, both pneumonia and COVID. Barbara Sperry is asking for prayers for a former member, Barbara Foltz, who is recovering from surgery. Bev and Joe Jewisak, prayers for their niece Christy and her family just diagnosed with breast cancer. Nancy LaRosa is asking for prayers of healing for Jean. Marie Cooper is requesting prayers for Rich, who is to receive a liver transplant. Let us come before our Maker now in prayer. Almighty God, in Jesus Christ, you taught us to pray. Guide us by your Holy Spirit in this moment and always, that our prayers may serve your will and show your steadfast love. God, our Creator, we pray for the world that you have made. We have seen again in recent days the power of your creation, and pray for strength in the cleanup and recovery and all those who grieve the death of loved ones due to Hurricane Ida. We pray that you will overthrow in this world those who seek to do evil, that you will right what is wrong, that you will feed and satisfy those who thirst for justice, so that all your people may freely enjoy your creation and joyfully sing your praise. We give thanks on this day for new life, for Colette and Alexandra, for Declan and Finley. Bless their parents and families as they move into this new chapter of life. May this new gift draw them even closer to you. Merciful God, you bear the pain of the world. Look with compassion on those whose bodies are in need of restoration, upon Maria and William, Barbara and Christy, Rich and Jean, and others that we have named silently before you. Cheer them by your word. Bring them the strength and healing they seek. Use us to offer the compassion and companionship they need as further signs of your grace. God of comfort, stand with those who grieve this day, especially with Craig and with Sherry and their families. Give them once more clear assurance that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall ever separate them from your love. May we walk with them in their loss, listen as they lament, and encourage them with our presence as they move through these days and weeks ahead. Gracious God, you have called us to be the Church of Jesus Christ. As we move into the fall and beyond, keep us one in faith and service, breaking bread together and proclaiming the good news to the world. Enable us to dare like Daniel, that all may believe you are love and catch a glimpse of that love in us. Mighty God, whose word we trust, whose spirit enables us to pray, accept our petitions and further only those that bring about your purpose for the earth. Through Jesus Christ, who rules over all things and who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In response to all that God has shared with us, let us now bring our tithes and offerings.
Please pray with me. Generous God, over and over your grace sustains us. Over and over your love provides for us. Over and over your arm steadies us. We give you these gifts with gratitude and joy, thankful that you are God over all. Amen.
May the God of all hope fill you with hope in believing. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord with the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.